Governor Kim Reynolds remains annoyed about that plane coming into your screen there. It flew into Des Moines from California in April. It had 19 unaccompanied migrant children on it. At first, the Biden administration denied that this flight had taken place. Well, it took weeks for the governor's office, staff, for members of Congress in Iowa, and reporters to get the confirmation from the Biden administration that this flight indeed happened. Governor said she still doesn't really know all the answers.
They boarded these young girls on charter buses and took them out. And, you know, I've seen statistics that say that they've lost contact with 1 in 3 of the unaccompanied children that came here from January through May. So, you know, where are they and what's happening to them?
We don't know if they're in our state anymore.
No, most of them were transported out.
The governor says governors deserve to know when the federal government is moving migrants into their state, and that just is not happening under the Biden administration, she contends.
Making sure that when they're transporting illegal migrants and unaccompanied children, that they provide transparency and let the governors know we absolutely have no idea when they're being moved into our states. And, you know, we're responsible for them at that point, and I'm responsible to Iowans to keep them safe and secure. And so those are simple things that they can do to really make a big difference.
When you announce this trip, and surely when you return home, from the Democratic side, they say collectively this is just a photo op. Well, there's no reason for a governor of Iowa to be down here.
No, that's such a, you know, the data is the data. All they have to do is look at it. Talk to any governor in any state. Even if the Democratic governors were honest about what they were seeing in their states, they would talk about the increase in fentanyl, the increase in methamphetamine, the increase in guns and just, you know, trafficking. It's taking place. The data is there. We've seen a 500% increase in apprehensions. That doesn't mean it's not happening. I mean, we've got data that supports what's happening. So, you know, they're sticking their head in the sand. I'm being a realist, and I'm going to do what I can do to stop it down here at the border before it makes its way through Interstate 35 and Interstate 80 and into our communities across my state. So we do have a reason to be here. It's not stopping at the border, and the data supports that.
Back in July, you sent troopers and some agents here. Will there be a return mission
so,
for them?
You know, I talked to Greg about that, and we talked to the Texas State Patrol. They were so appreciative of us sending law enforcement. We have Iowa National Guard down here in Arizona. We just brought back a group that had been here since for almost a year. So we'll continue to work with them. Again, I think the president of the Border Patrol Association was adamant that this could be changed tomorrow if they would implement the policies that they need to implement. And it works. You know, again, he's got data to support that. But if they're not going to do that, then states are going to have to step up and help, you know, Texas and Arizona protect this country and secure our borders and keep American citizens safe. And so, you know, we'll take a look at that and see what we need to do. But first and foremost, you know, the president owns this. He could start it tomorrow. This is a self-inflicted crisis. He reversed all of the policies that were working, and he could turn that around tomorrow if he would step up and lead. And he should be the one sending funding and support down to our border to keep Americans safe. And he has just not shown any willingness to do that whatsoever.
For those who believe that turning away people who are leaving violence, gangs, drugs, mm-hmm. all the bad stuff back home, and then they try to get across and we send them back in mm-hmm. the policy, what do you say to them?
Well, you know, they'll just hold them until they go through the process. And that sends a message to everybody that those hundreds of thousands that are on their way here, that second round, all at some indication is it's double what we saw the last time. So that sends a message back to them that you're going to have to go back over to Mexico or the country. They're going to work on the process there. And if you qualify, then at that point you come on over. But, you know, for them
held in Mexico.
Yeah, because the process here, we've got them once they're here. And so if we send them back to Mexico, remain in Mexico until they go through the process, that word gets out, and that would help, I think, stop. That would have a big impact on the numbers that we're seeing heading this way.
A backlog, though, on both sides of the river. Now, a closer look at what we saw on each side of the border as we headed down the Rio Grande.
You're going to get the issue of PFD, personal flotation device. It's also a level 3A, so it's not only a flotation device, it's also a bulletproof vest for you.
It's the reminder that this is not just a sightseeing trip. Iowa's governor and her staff arrived as the agents finalized instructions for this trip along the Rio Grande.
the governors would divide up on the other boats after they strapped in. Security was ready for whatever came next. Patrols on this stretch between Texas and Mexico happen day and night.
And how many go out at a time?
So
typically,
it depends on the boat. On these boats, a full crew is six.
Six, okay.
We spot U.S. Border Patrol and Texas troopers on one shore, Mexicans on the other.
So with kids coming across the border, how do they, what do they do? They just sort of say, kids go.
That's Wyoming's governor in the cowboy hat.
As far as like unaccompanied children.
So that's all Border Patrol, you know, how they process.
No, but
I know that stuff kind of.
Did they just send them across on a floaty or what?
Smuggling people across the Rio Grande is huge money. Law enforcement told the governors that cartels make $400 million per month from it.
How could you even begin to manage this?
The Texas and Mexico border is 1,200 miles long.
Some is what's on our side.
Sure.
Certain areas are easier for them to come across and then blend in.
So this border is six times the width of Iowa.
It gives you a real appreciation of just the expansive territory that they have to cover, and it makes you understand why we see probably the volume that we do of people being smuggled across the border.
The federal law enforcement efforts through Homeland Security and the Border Patrol will continue along the southern border. But from the governor, I wanted to know, what happens next? For years, doesn't really matter whether it was Republicans or Democrats in charge in D.C., they failed to pass any kind of real immigration reform. So is it time for states to take over the effort?
If you have to secure the border, I mean, we have to stop the flow before we can have a legitimate conversation about how many people are here and what that looks like and how we move forward.
She maintains that Congress has to take the lead.
Is this newer or older fence?
Privately funded fence.
Whether it's paid for by donors or taxpayers, the governor believes additional fencing and border walls will help. But the debris you see discarded on the Mexican shoreline is a reminder of the risk that migrants will take to try to make it across. Yes, this can be a heartbreaking tour. But the governor says those seeking opportunity on America's shores have to reach it legally. They can't just come, no matter what they overcame.
We can't handle that. We're not prepared to do that, and it'll have an impact, a severe impact on not only Iowans, but Americans.
We've received dozens of messages from Iowans on why we also went down to the border to cover the governor's trip. An explanation next.